On 11th April 1814, Napoleon boarded HMS Undaunted at Fréjus and set sail for the island of Elba to begin his exile. His journey from Paris was fraught with danger, as royalist mobs stoned his coach and hanged him in effigy. By the end of April, Louis XVIII had been restored to the French throne at the invitation of the French Senate. A month later, the first Treaty of Paris was signed. France was to be contained within the borders of 1792. All the lands conquered by Napoleon were lost. France found herself isolated in Europe.
It was all over. On the 6th of April, 1814, Napoleon abdicated. His armies had been defeated in eastern France by overwhelming invasion forces, particularly Austrians and Prussians, and with Russian support. British troops had invaded southern France. Napoleon's marshals were no longer reliable, and indeed, it was in fact a collapse among his governing group and his military high command that helped force him to abdicate. That was it. The Allies, they didn't execute him, but he was sent into what was, by any standards, a humiliating exile. The man who'd been Emperor of the French, who'd been crowned with the crown of Charlemagne, who'd been King of Italy, was now left as a principality, a small island, Elba, off the coast of Italy.
Although he had accepted exile as inevitable, Napoleon had no intention that it should be permanent. For the time being, though, he settled down in his new home, the town of Porto Ferraio, where he was greeted enthusiastically by the local population. His first impressions of the island were not promising. There were signs of deprivation and poverty everywhere. Napoleon resolved to improve the lot of his new hosts.
Napoleon had a resiliency to him. He was able to pick up his spirits, and after he was exiled to Elba, he undertook being the Emperor of Elba with a passion. He built roads and fortifications, and he went around the town talking with people. He received delegations of visitors. He did everything he could to make it work. But there were problems.
He was certainly a very busy man and kept himself very busy. He didn't dwell on his misfortune, the misfortunes of his past. I think at the same time, he was very much harbouring an intent to leave the island at some stage, and he was certainly keeping a watchful eye out for what was going on in France.
He becomes aware of the growing unpopularity, well, in fact he'd never been particularly popular, of Louis XVIII in France, and he also, as his psychological strength recovers and his physical strength recovers, becomes more and more, feels curtailed in Elba, more and more determined to regain his position.
Napoleon's health began to improve as the spring water at Poggio helped to relieve his dysuria. He began supervising improvements to his house in Porto Ferraio, which he had decorated to look like an Egyptian temple. He set aside rooms for his wife and son, confident they would soon be joining him. He also continued to remain in contact with Josephine, who still kept Napoleon's apartments at Malmaison just as he had left them. But they were never to meet again. On 29th May, the former Empress died of diphtheria, aged only 50. Napoleon did, however, have two female companions on Elba, his 64-year-old mother, Letizia, and his sister, Pauline. But still Napoleon longed to see his wife and son, but Marie-Louise remained in Austria. Napoleon constantly wrote to her. She didn't reply. In January 1815, she sent Napoleon a formal New Year greeting and then disappeared from his life forever. Napoleon blamed his father-in-law for turning Marie-Louise against him. A keen supporter of the marriage when Napoleon was at the height of his power, Emperor Francis repudiated it now that his fortunes were at a low ebb. Money was becoming a problem for Napoleon and his family.
The Treaty of Fontainebleau had given Napoleon a fairly sizable pension, which was to be paid by the French, Louis XVIII. Louis XVIII refused to pay anything to Napoleon. Now the British, among others, urged Louis, please pay the pension. Don't give this Corsican ogre a chance, an excuse to cause more trouble. Let him live peacefully in Elba and leave us alone. But again, for reasons that don't make any sense at all, the French refused to do that.
Louis had refused to pay Napoleon the agreed pension of 2 million francs. So what was Napoleon to do? Sit on Elba and starve, or have a last throw of the die? He chose the throw.
Louis XVIII, gout-ridden and sexually impotent, was proving to be an unpopular monarch.
The return of Louis XVIII hoist all kinds of warning signals for revolutionaries old and new in France. I forget who it was who said that the trouble with the Bourbons was they'd forgotten nothing and learned nothing. And that did seem to be the case in the immediate aftermath of Louis XVIII's return.
Faithful to my motto, everything for the French people, I resolved to return to France, not for the ambitious purpose of regaining my throne, but to place myself between the factions. I had always thought that France wished only for equality, and I had given her perfect equality. I had now learned from events that she was likewise desirous of liberty, and I resolved to make France the freest nation in the world.
On 15th February 1815, Napoleon's former foreign minister, Hugh Bernard Marais, sent a secret ambassador to Elba begging him to return. Napoleon was cautious. As a keen student of history, he knew that few exiles had staged successful comebacks. But if Marais thought he could succeed, he resolved to take the chance. His mother agreed. "You're doing the right thing. Better to die sword in hand than in an unworthy retirement." At dusk on 26 February, Napoleon set sail on the Inconstant.
On March the 1st, Napoleon's little entourage in three ships and maybe 1,000 men sets foot on French soil for the first time in almost a year. Now, Napoleon has to be concerned about how he is going to return. He needs, at all costs, to avoid any fighting. As soon as there's any kind of a pitched battle, he's probably done for. He needs to develop the sense among the French and among those people in the rest of Europe that he is coming back because the people want him. And so he takes a fairly out-of-the-way route through the mountains up toward Grenoble.
The army set off at midnight. Eager to reach his goal as soon as possible and surprise Louis, Napoleon headed straight across the Alps. With only brief stops for food and sleep, they marched on through snow and ice, climbing to 3,500 feet. By 4th March, they had reached Dain, where they were warmly welcomed. In another 2 days, they would be in Grenoble. Napoleon issued a proclamation calling on the French army to join him.
"If the people and army don't want me, at the first encounter, 30 or 40 of my men will be killed. The rest will throw down their muskets. I shall be finished, and France will be quiet. If the people and the army do want me, and I hope they will, the first battalion I meet will throw itself into my arms. The rest will follow."
Louis XVIII found out very quickly that Napoleon landed at Antibes as the new semaphore system instituted, well, it began in 1794, had spread the news to Paris very quickly. And up he gets and moves as fast as his corpulent bulk would allow. And I can't say I blame him. After all, his brother had been executed in January 1793, as indeed had several other members of his family, including his sister-in-law, the Queen Marie Antoinette, and his cousin, the Duke of Orléans, and many other friends and family. So I don't blame Louis XVIII for cutting and running. After all, there were still a lot of radicals, a lot of old Jacobins in Paris who would have welcomed the opportunity to finish the job and to sever the head of another member of the Bourbon family.
Louis was a pragmatist. He was aware of the increasing popular support which Napoleon was receiving. He also did not wish to plunge his country, his newly adopted country, into civil war. These factors weighed heavily with him, and he decided to lay down the throne, lay down the crown, and leave the country.
Marshal Soult, now Minister of War, planned to intercept Napoleon at Lyon. He sent a message by semaphore telegraph to Grenoble, ordering guns to be dispatched to Lyon. Surprisingly, the press thought the whole business scarcely worth a mention.
An act of madness which can be dealt with by a few rural policemen.
He goes along the mountain road, and quite honestly, his reception at first is rather mixed. People who see him as he goes through their towns or along the roads are rather curious at all this. Who, Napoleon is back? What's that all about? And they're not exactly wildly enthusiastic because they don't really know what to make of it all. But the further he goes, he begins to pick up more and more people. He has interviews with people along the way, and he begins to talk about how he no longer wants to conquer territories. He simply wants to rule France. He wants to bring back the revolution. He wants to bring back enlightenment to the people of France. He says, I'm old and I'm fat. I really don't need to conquer any more territory. And I happen to think that that's true. I think he realized that his only real chance, number one, to gain the support of the French people, and number two, to have the people of the rest of Europe allow him to return without contesting it, was to convince them that he only wanted to rule France itself.
2 mornings later, in the village of Cap, Napoleon was wakened with urgent news. Pierre Cambron, in command of the advance guard, reported that a battalion of the 5th Line Regiment was only a few miles north under Major Delessart. Despite having 1,100 men to Delessart's 700, Napoleon was in no mood to fight his own countrymen. He had a deep abhorrence of civil war. He ordered Cambron not to open fire. Instead, he ordered his Polish lancers to advance slowly. Delessart withdrew his men, and Napoleon ordered the lancers to wheel and return. Unfurling his tricolour, Napoleon commanded the guards band to strike up the Marseillaise. As the men of the 5th stood entranced, Napoleon rode forward and dismounted. Someone recognized the former emperor and gave the order to fire. Napoleon opened his familiar grey overcoat and exposed his white waistcoat as a target to the soldiers.
And he says, you know, soldiers of the 5th Regiment, if you wish to kill your emperor, here I am. And there's a moment of silence. Somebody cries out, Vive l'Empereur, long live the Emperor, and all chaos breaks loose. They all mob him. The officer that had been trying to get them to fire, of course, is totally out of it at that point. And all of the soldiers go to him.
Waving their shakos on the tips of their bayonets, the soldiers rushed to embrace him. They tore the white cockades from their hats and replaced them with the tricolor ribbons banned by King Louis, which they still carried in their knapsacks.
They were hankering, all these old soldiers, after the glory days from 1796 to 1809, when they had rampaged all over Europe, raping, murdering, looting, pillaging, and getting patted on the back for it. They weren't terribly interested in peace and poverty, so when Napoleon appeared, all the old glory immediately was received by them. They were hungry for him to come back. They thought no further than, let's have another glorious battle and win it. So one by one, 10 by 10, regiment by regiment, they fell under his spell and flocked to his banners.
The reaction of many of the French people was one of, here comes an adventurer, a gambler, and very little attention was paid to it, particularly within Paris itself. But as his advance towards Paris continued, and so the numbers that went across to him increased, then I think he was looked towards as a potential, not saviour, but certainly a restorer.
At 7 o'clock that evening, Napoleon learned that a dense column of troops had been sighted, marching south in battle formation. Although clearly outnumbered, Napoleon prepared to resist them and ordered his men into defensive positions. He was in luck. he recognized their commander as Charles de Labédoyère, colonel of the 7th Regiment of the Line. The young officer at once surrendered and embraced Napoleon. Together, they combined forces and handed over the regimental colors, marched onto Grenoble, where they found the town stoutly defended by 2,000 men. A band of local peasants, some 2,000 strong, marched up and down under the walls.
He walks in triumph through the gates of Grenoble. The officials of Grenoble refuse to open the gates for him, and so the citizens tear them down and later present Napoleon with the shattered pieces of wood that made up the gates and said, "Since they would not open the gates for you, we have destroyed them, and here they are." Napoleon said that he was, once he got to Grenoble, he was once again a reigning prince. Before he had been an adventurer, now he was a reigning prince.
Well, because the game's up. I mean, Napoleon's advancing, the population realized that they don't have to put up with this Bourbon monarchy anymore. There is an alternative, and that alternative is in Napoleon.
Napoleon entered to a tumultuous reception. At inn, he was hoisted onto the shoulders of the cheering citizens and carried upstairs in triumph. And his return to the throne now seemed assured. But an obstacle lay in his way, in the shape of his old comrade, Marshal Ney.
There were several of his old marshals who decided not to throw their hands in with him for various reasons, and Berthier, for one, accompanied the king to Ghent. Other leading figures had had enough of Napoleon and his incessant war-making. They had become rich, they'd become fat cats, but they'd never been able to enjoy it. You can't enjoy being a fat cat when you're being frozen to death on the steppes of Russia. So no, they had their estates, they wanted to enjoy them. The lure of Napoleon had faded for them, and they decided that they wanted no more of him.
Marshal Ney, who had been his trusted marshal, the bravest of the brave in Russia and so on, had become rather comfortable with his lifestyle with Louis XVIII and swore to Louis XVIII that he would go and bring Napoleon back in an iron cage. And he proceeded to try to do that. But he soon discovered that his soldiers were about to have none of it, and if he tried to bring Napoleon back in an iron cage, he'd have a little revolt on his hands. So he switched his position, gave a proclamation to his soldiers. "Soldiers, we are about to join the great phalanx that is marching toward Paris. Will you join me and regain the glory of the empire, etc., etc.?" And of course, Napoleon was real glad to have Ney, because that was the last real obstacle between him and Paris.
Napoleon had promised to be in Paris by 20th of March, and at 9 o'clock that evening, 20,000 wildly cheering citizens greeted his entry into the city. He had covered the route from Cap d'Antibes in half the normal time.
"What we have just achieved is the people's doing and yours. All I did was to understand and appreciate you."
Once more, he was Emperor of France.
He sails to France, lands on the Provence coast, and goes north. By March 20th, he is in Paris. Not a shot has been fired to stop him. Louis XVIII had sent Marshal Ney, but marked to capture him, as Marshal Ney had promised to do. But Marshal Ney turned back to support Napoleon, and Louis XVIII is forced to flee.
When he gets there, he's very much aware of the fact that if he's going to operate once again as head of state, he's going to have to operate in a constitutional monarchy environment. And to that end, he makes a number of overtures to the Liberals to see if he can get their support.
The Liberals certainly would be difficult to win over. One of the most articulate of their number was Benjamin Constant.
"He has reappeared. This man died in our blood. He is another Attila, another Genghis Khan, but more terrible and hateful because he has at his disposal the resources of civilization."
Instead of ordering Constant's imprisonment, Napoleon invited him to the Tuileries to reassure him and to explain his intentions. The new constitution, the Acte Additionnel, was drawn up, and on 12th April, a plebiscite was held. The result was overwhelming. Over 1.3 million voted in favor, a mere 4,206 against. Even Benjamin Constant was satisfied.
Napoleon went to great lengths after his reinstatement in Paris to put the clock back to 1813, early 1814. He obliterated all the reforms in the army which Louis had put through. He gave the regiments back their sacred old numbers, which had been rubbed out by the king. He gave them back their tricolour cockade under which they'd fought so bravely. He called them to arms to defend France, not defend him, to defend France against the Allies. And the call was pretty much irresistible for all Frenchmen. They flocked to his banners.
What he seeks to do is to re-establish his old regime, the Bonapartist old regime, suitably modified. He makes all kinds of concessions to contemporary public opinion. He indicates that he will not be running such a tight ship, but it won't be so much of a police state. There will be more freedom of opinion and all the other civil liberties. There will be more constitutional representation and consultation and so on. There will be less of the militaristic ambitions of the past. All this rhetoric pours from him in a constant stream. Whether anybody believed or not is a different matter. But this is a very short period, remember. It is only 100 days. And his major, the thing he had to spend most time on was getting some kind of army together to prevent retribution from the Duke of Wellington and Marshal Blücher.
During Napoleon's exile, France had signed an alliance with England and Austria, and many in England were reluctant to break it now that Napoleon was once more emperor. One English member of Parliament was typical of the general consensus.
Bonaparte has been welcomed back to France as a liberator. It would be monstrous to declare war on a people in order to impose a government they do not want.
Talleyrand, however, wished to turn the Allies against Napoleon. He was at a ball with Wellington, Metternich and Tsar Alexander when news of Napoleon's return reached Vienna. Talleyrand persuaded England, Austria, Russia and Prussia each to put 150,000 men in the field to crush the emperor forever. The emperor sent his special envoy, Montrand, to Metternich to sue for peace. He also wrote a letter in his own hand to the Prince Regent in England. Metternich refused to see the envoy. The Prince Regent's letter was returned unopened. War was now inevitable.
There was one real flaw in his strategy, and it was something he really couldn't avoid because he needed to act fast when it came to the timing for leaving Elba. But the Congress of Vienna was still going on. So all of these leaders of the various coalitions against him were still where they could quickly make decisions. He sent letters pleading for peace. He sent letters, you know, to his father-in-law, the Emperor of Austria, saying, my father-in-law, please send my wife to me. Please send my son to me. I want to have peace. I want nothing else. Sent the same thing to the Emperor of Russia and so forth and so on. But they were having none of it. They declared him an international outlaw, whatever that is, and said, we are not just going to fight France. We are not just fighting Napoleon. We're going to crush him. We're going to send armies against him. So Napoleon couldn't avoid having fight in order to maintain his position.
It's not clear that there was ever really any alternative to the resumption of war. Certainly, the Allied powers in Vienna had no intention of, you know, responding to any peace tentatives from Napoleon. And they began planning a war to put Louis XVIII back on the throne. Napoleon, in turn, tries to rebuild the army, an army that has been devastated by years of fighting, an army that, for example, lots of the horses had been eaten or had died on the invasion of Russia, and the French cavalry was never as good again. Attempts to build an army, but he also knows that he has to strike fast. After all, against him there will definitely be the British, the Austrians, the Russians, the Prussians, as well as a host of other lesser allied powers.
From King Louis, Napoleon inherited an army of 100,000. Soon it had expanded to 300,000 loyal Frenchmen who had flocked to the colours of their own volition. In early June, English and Prussian forces began to assemble in Belgium, ready to launch an invasion on France. Receiving word that the Austrians and Russians were not yet fully mobilised, Napoleon decided to attack first.
What he decides to do is to try and defeat the opposing armies in what is then Belgium. He decides to try and defeat those in order to provide such a convincing account of his own military success that will rally support to him within France and encourage other powers in Europe to accept his return to power and to deal with him. The Austrians and the Russians are the European powers that are slowest to deploy. Their troops have the longest to go, furthest to go, and also their armies are just slow to deploy. And in Belgium, there are two forces that he has to engage. There's a Prussian army under Marshal Blücher, and there is a force, a mixture of British, Dutch, and some allied German units under Arthur Wellesley, now Duke of Wellington. Neither of them are brilliant forces. The key units in the British army, including many of the units that fought under Wellesley in the peninsula, are in fact at that time still in North America, just after the end of the 1812 war with the Americans. So there is an opportunity. And what Napoleon determines to do is to try and defeat the forces opposed to him separately. And he has to do that in a sense because they outnumber him 2-1.
On 11th June, he left Paris. 2 days later, he arrived at Arvin, where an army of 125,000 was waiting for him. At dawn on 15th June, he took the Russians by surprise and captured Charleroi.
The Prussians were surprised by Napoleon's rapid advance to Charleroi, partially the fault of the commander on the spot, partially the fault of the Prussian High Command, who exposed him in that position and failed to support him in response to his reports of increased activity. They were thrust back towards Ligny.
The following day, the Prussians took up their position at Ligny, with Wellington at Quatre Bras, 7 miles to the northwest. Napoleon planned that Ney, who commanded the left, should attack Quatre Bras before pressing on to Brussels.
The French invade Belgium on the 15th of June. The next day, contact, battle. The Prussians are at Ligny. Napoleon attacks them. He wants an attack on front, flank and rear to destroy the Prussians. Marshal Ney is supposed to move via Quatre Bras to push back the British there, or any British that might be there, and to attack the Prussians in the flank and rear. He doesn't do so.
Ney hesitated, and at 1 o'clock, Napoleon sent a second order.
I'm surprised at your long delay in carrying out my commands. There is no time to lose. Attack with greatest impetuosity everything in front of you.
Ney was only initially fighting against a very small force, and he could have easily swept them aside and taken the campaign north to Wellington himself. But for some reason, Ney was quite timid. He seemed convinced that he was facing the major part of Wellington's army, and as a result, he was reluctant to move forward. It was a little unlike the brash, bravest of the brave, Marshal Ney. But the fact is, he stalled and delayed and was very timid. And in the meantime, Wellington, in fact, was sending more and more soldiers into the area so that by the time Marshal Ney finally decided to do anything about it, he was facing a pretty formidable force of British and other soldiers.
Wellington was coming up with increasing forces, and by 5 o'clock that evening, Wellington had a superiority of about 3-2 over Ney, and the opportunity was gone.
Napoleon, on the other hand, was fighting the Prussians at Ligny, and he was having a great deal more success. The Prussians retreated.
Napoleon, though outnumbered, came within an ace of capturing Blücher. Ney's vacillation, though, meant that he had to abandon his plan to take Brussels. The next day, he visited the wounded Prussians in Ligny. He gave them brandy and directed that their wounds should be dressed. He then detached 30,000 men under Emmanuel de Grouchy to pursue the remaining Prussians.
I would submit that he could have sent Grouchy, Marshal Grouchy, with his soldiers an immediate attack. If nothing else, it would have shown them exactly where the Prussians were going, and they could have, you know, done it a few more of them. But he waited and he waited and he waited until the next morning. Finally, he gets around to telling Grouchy to pursue Marshal Blücher of the Prussians. Now it takes Grouchy hours to get his soldiers up and going. It's early afternoon, anyway, before the pursuit continues, and they don't know for sure exactly where the Prussians went. This is important because it's this delay that really allows the Prussians under Marshal Blücher to move into position where they ultimately can support the forces of Wellington at Waterloo.
Napoleon then decides that he will turn on the British.
In pouring rain, Napoleon and Ney pursued the English as they retreated towards Brussels. 6 miles further on, Wellington took up a position on Mont Saint-Jean, a piece of high ground near the village of Waterloo. Napoleon made his headquarters to the south at a nearby farm called Le Caillon. Next morning, as Napoleon breakfasted with his generals, his brother Jerome brought fresh intelligence. Blücher planned to march from Wavre to join Wellington.
Stupidity. After a battle like Ligny, it is impossible for them to join forces. We have 90 chances in our favour, and not 10 against us.
The British and the Austrians are special in this sense that they had been fighting more or less continuously since 1792 in the case of the Austrians, 1793 in the case of the British, had expended gigantic sums of treasure and oceans of blood over the previous quarter of a century. The Austrians had gone bankrupt in 1811. The British were suffering serious financial difficulties, as indeed all the powers were. So there's a general determination to put a stop to this menace once and for all.
The good old war horse Blücher had decided to go, much against his chief of staff's advice. His chief of staff was Gneisenau, who harboured some resistance, who acting together with the British. Blücher ordered them to make for Plancenoit, for Waterloo, as fast as they could, and to join the battle, the final battle, against Napoleon.
At 11 o'clock, after an hour's sleep, Napoleon woke refreshed and took up position on high ground near the farm of Rossomme. Mounted on his white mare, Désiré, he surveyed the field. He must have been extremely confident. The rain had stopped, and his army was numerically superior, having 72,000 men against 68,000. He also boasted 90 more guns. At 11:25, Napoleon gave the signal for his guns to open fire, whilst Jerome attacked the enemy's right in order to draw off troops from Wellington's centre. The bombardment continued for an hour and a half. Then Napoleon ordered the Comte d'Erlon's first corps to attack.
Napoleon, in the end, is to be castigated for the French tactics at Waterloo. In particular, it's to be argued that successive frontal attacks played to the strength of the defensive firepower of the British and Allied forces, and that he didn't outmaneuver his opponents. There's some truth in that. I mean, it could have been a battle that could have been, he could have tried to make much more of an attempt to outflank his opponents or to attack them hard in the flank. He doesn't. Why? Well, in part, time. He wants a quick battle. He wants to engage them before they can retreat. In part, his actual physical and mental state. He's ill, he's tired, he's run down. And I think it's fair to say that there are also specific problems with the French army. It's a new one. It is underpowered in terms of artillery. The artillery itself, the deployment is delayed by overnight rainfall, which has ensured that the soil, the clay soil, has become a bit waterlogged, so that delays the battle. But having said that, it is still a battle that has to be fought.
The artillery pounding had caused surprisingly little damage in the English ranks. Knowing the power of the French artillery, Wellington had drawn his men back on the reverse slopes. He then moved them to the top of the ridge, where they fired down on Delong's troops, inflicting substantial losses.
The guard were confronted by some opponents who were not exactly slouches themselves, and the British Army's reputation for musketry was beautifully upheld at Waterloo. They shot the guard to pieces, and the guard couldn't take it, and they crumbled and fled.
As the French retreated, the Scots Greys pursued them. Napoleon sent in the 6th and 9th Cuirassiers against them. The Scots were wiped out, but at a price. The French had lost 5,000 men. At 1:30 in the afternoon, Napoleon moved his headquarters to La Belle Alliance. There, a surprise awaited him. Jerome's intelligence had been correct. Blücher's advance guard had arrived. Suddenly, Napoleon was forced to fight on two fronts.
The appearance of Blücher on the scene at Waterloo in 1815, in a way, is of symbolic importance. Blücher was a very elderly gent by the standards of Napoleonic warfare. And yet, he possessed the necessary reserves of physical stamina and moral courage to get his army, which man for man was probably the best army in any of the Allied combat units, or indeed and certainly superior to Napoleon's troops, to get them going and to get them there in time. Blücher was a very interesting, extremely aggressive and bloodthirsty person who hated Napoleon and the French and was seeking to avenge, as he saw it, a deep sense of humiliation inflicted on Prussia by Napoleon after 1806. So, in a way, Blücher personifies a major change which has taken place in the way in which the old regime powers waged war. Now they have learned all the lessons of French revolutionary and Napoleonic warfare and are applying them with deadly effect against those that created them in the first place.
Ney launched the main assault against Wellington, even though horse after horse was shot from beneath him. At 6:30, his efforts were rewarded when he captured the farm of La Haye Sainte. Napoleon needed to act swiftly before Blücher's main force arrived. His plan was to send 5 battalions of guards up the slopes of Mont Saint-Jean under the command of Marshal Ney. Despite quick and accurate fire from the English, the guards pressed on. At this point, a second Prussian corps, under the Graf von Zieten, arrived and attacked the guards from the right. At the same time, Wellington sent 3 regiments of hussars charging down the hill, where they broke one of the guards' squares. News rapidly spread. The guards, once thought invincible, had been scattered in confusion. Napoleon now knew all was lost. He tried to retreat in good order.
One could always ask the hypothetical question, what would have happened had the Prussians not arrived? I think what I would say is that late in the day, a final breakthrough, even if it had occurred as a result of the French committal of the Guard against the British, would not have been the enormous blow that it would have been earlier in the day, because it would not have been possible to exploit the victory as one would have been able to do if one had had, you know, many hours of daylight left.
Napoleon's first instinct was to rally his troops at Charleroi and continue fighting. But there were already fears that back in Paris the assembly might surrender in his absence. He hastily returned to the capital, arriving at 7 o'clock on the morning of 21st June. The strain of battle and 3 sleepless nights had taken their toll. Napoleon was a very sick man. Louis Davout, his faithful minister of war, urged Napoleon to dissolve the assembly. Instead, he demanded they grant him full powers. They refused. The Allies would never make peace whilst Napoleon remained emperor. He was given an ultimatum: abdicate or be deposed. Seeing no alternative, Napoleon agreed to abdicate. Napoleon retreated to Malmaison. On 3rd July, he arrived at Rochefort to find it blockaded by the English warship, the Bellerophon.
He does try to make a run for it. An elaborate plan was devised by which he would be whisked away in a frigate to the United States of America and take refuge there. But when he gets to the coast, instead he's recognised and he surrenders to the British on the Bellerophon.
I come, like Themistocles, to throw myself on the hospitality of the British people. I place myself under the protection of their laws.
Napoleon was taken by the British to St. Helena, 6,000 miles from nowhere, with no prospect of ever returning.
The British, to their credit, didn't put him in a prison or have him executed. But to their enormous discredit, they put him on an unhealthy island and they treated him as though he were a common prisoner instead of a former emperor. They didn't do that with other kings and monarchs who sought asylum. Napoleon had sought asylum with the British and the British government had refused it.
I wonder whether he remembered something he'd said earlier contemptuously about the Austrians, whom he had just defeated for the nth time. He said, "The trouble with the Austrians is that they're always one army and one idea behind the rest of Europe." But the French historian Albert Sorel added, "The Austrians always had an army and they always had an idea. It was Napoleon who ran out of both."
His last years were spent in exile on St. Helena, where he had leisure to brood upon his mistakes and pen his memoirs. Where had it all gone so wrong?
"I have fought 60 battles, and I assure you that I have learned nothing from all of them that I did not know in the first."
On 5th May 1821, after a long and painful illness, Napoleon died. Some authorities say it was through inhaling arsenic fumes from the wallpaper in his room over a long period. Others claim he was deliberately poisoned.
The common belief for many, many years was that he died of stomach cancer. The belief now is increasingly among scholars of this period that he was poisoned by arsenic, which weakened his condition. And then at the very end, he was given a series of relatively common substances which finally did him in and caused him to die.
When, 4 days later, his coffin was lowered into the earth, the route was lined with English soldiers, their heads bowed in respectful silence. A great man had died. A legend was about to be born.
We often position Napoleon in terms of a grand trajectory of military history. You move from Frederick the Great and the Prussians in the mid-18th century to the revolutionaries, the French revolutionaries in the 1790s and the start of popular warfare. Then we move to Napoleon and then we move on eventually in the 19th century to the Prussians as they become the Germans under Moltke and the wars of German unification. And the idea is it's quite clear. Napoleon is the cutting edge for his period of modernity, of military modernity. He is going to succeed, and in the end he is only stopped when other powers have sort of developed their forces to match what the French can do.
Napoleon was a spirit of enlightenment. Napoleon was trying to reform, to improve the lives of people. He fought wars because, in many cases, those wars were foisted upon him by these various coalitions that didn't want improvement in the lives of people. The Austrians and the Russians and the Prussians were afraid that their own people would get the idea of freedom and equality and the liberty given under the civil code and so on. Napoleon is seen by people throughout the world, even today, as the father of modern Europe, maybe as the father of the European Union, as someone who stood for moving out of the old order and into the new order. Was it an imperfect move? Of course. Was Napoleon imperfect? Of course he was. He did overextend. He did get a little greedy. Maybe he shouldn't have done this or done that. But if you take him as a whole, if you look at Napoleon as a whole, you see someone who added a great deal of positive impetus to the history of the world. And there's not very many people in world history that you can truly say that about. Napoleon is one of them. The world is, in the final analysis, better off for his having existed.
How was the spying game played during the Cold War? The full extent of KGB, CIA, MI6 and Stasi covert operations revealed in a four-part series starting tomorrow on UK History at the same time.